Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and today is a continuation of the clinical approach to severe narcissistic and borderline personality disorders according to Otto Kernberg and object relations theory. Last week I touched on the beginnings of the therapeutic relationship with a borderline or narcissist as they work through the depressive position from infancy, and what that briefly entails. Today Kernberg talks about trauma and its manifestations as a result. It is important to keep in mind that the types of narcissistic and borderline pathologies he talks about are the worst-case scenarios, but the takeaway with such exaggerations is learning the mechanics of the personality structures in general. That is, most narcissists and borderlines, no matter where they lie on the spectrum, operate in the same way. By taking apart the most obvious, it will help you to apply this to the lesser narcissist, where their behaviors would be more subtle, and thus, more apt to miss. What we already know is that aggression overtakes and transforms into what most of us have witnessed on the receiving end of narcissistic abuse. Because Kernberg talks about cases of incest, or severe sexual and physical abuse, it shouldn't be assumed that your garden variety narcissist or borderline suffered such things at all. On the contrary, from my point of view, which is a developmental approach, and in my experience, the many narcissists I have known had quite comfortable and uneventful childhoods compared to, quote, normal people. However, the abuse they inflicted on others was, to say the least, remarkable. So, I will never encourage you to feel sorry for the narcissist, nor am I saying give them a pass. The golden rule for everyone is that once you're an adult, nothing is grounds for abusing or exploiting another person, period. Because they may, or may not have had a traumatic childhood, always keep in mind that narcissists are pathological liars, and will say anything that will give them the most supply. I just want to be clear, my only goal is to understand them so I can spot the signs and symptoms, so that I can get far away from them as quickly as possible. To reiterate, it is only fair to talk about the trauma that most severe pathologies may have been through, and by examining extremes you then learn how the everyday narcissist or borderline operates in general. Better to know the enemy than not know, right? Anyway, Kernberg says, trauma as the actual experience of sadistic behavior on the part of the needed, inescapable object, instantaneously shapes rage reaction into hatred of the sadistic object. And that makes sense, of course, as he goes on to say that the prevalence of physical abuse, sexual abuse, and the witnessing of violence in patients with severe psychopathology is a significant etiological factor. Where etiological is defined as the investigation or attribution of the cause or reason for something, often expressed in terms of historical or mythical explanation. Kernberg reminds us again that the establishment of an internalized object relation under the control of structured rage is hatred. When hatred overwhelmingly dominates an unconscious world of internalized object relations, primitive splitting operations persist, resulting in a borderline personality organization characterized by an internal world of idealized and persecutory object relations with a dominance of the latter. And here's really getting to the heart of the matter, describing the borderline personality structure and how it is formed in theory. Note here that this is the prevailing assumption. That trauma is the cause of personality disorders, which I do believe is true in some cases. Where I differ is that I believe that personality disorders are developmental disorders, meaning that everything's already in place, if you will, to either be made worse or better. And Kernberg does explore this a bit when talking about temperament, that is, the constitutionally given and genetically determined disposition toward intense activation of aggression. That said, the rage the infant suffers begins to organize into the affect of hatred, which later becomes chronic and stable, or characterologically anchored. Remember, it is here that development stops, and the ego and superego fail to integrate. The borderline is now perceiving the world through either idealized, or persecutory object relations, which then sets them up for paranoia. So there will be paranoid tendencies, characterologically structured egocentric sadism, and vengefulness, disassociated efforts are made to escape from a persecutory world by means of illusory and associated idealizations. Under traumatic conditions then, the basic mechanisms would include the immediate transformation of pain into rage and of rage into hatred. Hatred then consolidates the unconscious identification with victim and victimizer. Which is really important to understand here if you're confused about why the narcissist is claiming to be the victim of you. The narcissist, at some point in a relationship with someone, will truly believe they are the victim, while simultaneously victimizing you further. In their heads, they have internalized and ossified their perception of the relationship they had with the primary caregiver. Of course, the internalized mother is the victimizer, and they are the victim. When they're adults, they will replay this relationship, or object relation, onto an unwitting substitute, and this can be observed by watching them switch in and out of their ego states. One minute they're the critical parent, the next they're the hurt little child crying to someone else about how awful you are, and then in their adult state, which is the false self, they play make-believe hero. This same process plays out in the Karpman drama triangle, where you have persecutor, victim, and rescuer. Suffice it to say, we all have ego states. However, a mature adult will mostly be just that, and might slip into critical parent from time to time, but nothing like the drama queen, narcissist, or borderline. When you can observe and identify this process in everyone, you'll be keen to spot a potentially toxic person. Kernberg goes on to say that the most clinical manifestation of the dominance of hatred in the transference is the patient's attribution to the therapist of an intense, relentless degree of hatred. And we all know by now that this is pure projection. So, by what mechanisms does this one man show insanity play out? By projective identification, of course. And through this process, the internal world of torturer and tortured, tyrant and slave is enacted. The narcissist will assign the role of tyrant to the therapist, and keep in mind when I'm describing this, this is exactly what is happening to their intimate other. Next, the narcissist makes unconscious efforts to provoke him into such a role by inducing conditions, i.e., manipulation, and counter-transference that eventually activate whatever role responsiveness the therapist possesses in order to fulfill the narcissist's fearful expectations, and to control him in order to limit his dangerousness. In other words, in the narcissist's internal world of object relations, which, by the way, have nothing to do with you as this is all playing out in their own head, will assign you a role. In my case, with ex-malignant narc 2, it was to be the persecutor or tyrant, just like in the therapist's example. He would manipulate situations to create conditions to get the reactions he wanted. And I felt at the time, he wanted me to scream and argue with him. But, because I was so confused, and couldn't even figure out what we were arguing about, I told him, "I'm not going to yell at you if that's what you're trying to do here." So you can see how he wanted, and tried to find in me, violent reactions towards him, thereby fulfilling the role he was trying to assign to me. When that didn't work, he then became the tyrant, controlling every aspect of my life. And, as Kernberg says, this is to limit the dangerousness of the bad object. Recall way back to the paranoid schizoid position and why this is the case. The infant rages against a highly needed and loved object, and this is because their intrapsychic structure is in part objects, where there is only good and bad. That hatred, in the form of fantasy, is projected onto the good object, or mother. Once that hateful fantasy is projected, it comes back into the psyche as an introject. Remember, an infant can't tell the difference between reality and fantasy yet. So, now that bad introject is felt as very real, and feelings of persecution and anxiety follow, with the infant fearing that the bad object will be out to get them now. The same thing is happening in the narcissist's mind, just like that of the infant. The bad object that they are projecting all their hateful fantasies onto will then become the persecutor, and the narcissist fears that the bad object will do to them what they are doing to it. Hence the paranoia. To summarize, the transferences and projections of the narcissist are meant to provoke the therapist into a reaction. That counter-transference reaction, if that should happen, would prove to the narcissist that they were right, and that indeed the therapist was a bad object or tyrant. Then the narcissist could play the role of victim, a role they love to covet. Of course, with a good therapist this wouldn't happen, and in all likelihood the narcissist would then revert to the tyrant role, commencing with relentless attacks on the therapist. Eventually this puts the narcissist in a paranoid stance, fearing that the therapist will be out to get him. And this is right where the therapist needs to get the narcissist, because according to Kernberg, this sweet spot shows some hope for improvement, and the realization for the patient that what drama is playing out in their head, is really all in their head. Well, that's it for this week, and if you found this content helpful, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and comment. You can find me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at Clumber_Lover with a U. As always, sending you all my love and gratitude, and I do hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know I am.